how I wanted to start. But I wanted to say why we are looking at tree almost automorphisms. As you can see, this is the title of my talk, tree almost automorphisms. And why? Why one would look at that? Because it gave the first examples of simple groups which do not have any lattices. So in this midrasha, the lattices turned up every now and then, and so maybe by now we are convinced that they are important. So it's also cool to know whether there's a thing which cannot have any. And even though I will not fully prove it, these are such examples which I will talk today. Compact, simple. So now let T be a tree. This is some funny curly. I don't know, curly or script T. And we assume two things on it. It does not have leaves, and it does not have isolated points in its boundary.
Can you remind what is a lattice in this context? Like
A discrete subgroup such that the quotient has a finite invariant for a measure. And without fixed points in the boundary. Did Gil denote the boundary like this when she was introducing it? Okay. Yeah, fixed points are right. Isolated. So this tree will be fixed throughout the talk. Later in the second half, it will be regular, like the one over there. Now comes the main definition. It's a bit long because it packs some things in it. So consider two finite subtrees. And then the complement can be viewed as a forest. Right, so if you look here, say this here, like everything above this red line is a finite subtree, like with this here. Then the complement is a forest consisting of many components looking like this. One hanging here, one hanging here, one hanging here. So that's a bit funny. I take a tree, I cut out a finite subtree, I get a forest, but that's how it works. And then an almost automorphism of tree is A, and wait, I leave some space here, so I'm not done. Forest isomorphism so from the complement of one tree to the complement of the other tree. So here, I could cut out this tree, and on the other side, okay, this has 112, I think, nodes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yep. And now I need to find something else with 12 nodes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So I can cut out, for example, this here. If I cut out here that, and I cut here this, which I indicated here, like this is so, like up here, right? I cut, and I cut. I have a very nice saw. Okay. Then on both sides, I have 12 copies of this binary tree. A forest on both sides. I have a forest consisting of 12 copies of this binary tree. So there are many forest isomorphisms between them. I just need to map these roots here, because in that case these roots are the only ones who are who have degree 2. So I need to map the roots of these trees there to the roots over there. And then here I can map it however I want. We can, for example, map this tree here on this tree here, in whatever way I want. So that's an almost automorphism. Almost? It's almost an almost automorphism. Yeah?
Can the finite subtree be empty? Like, is it automorphism?
Then you'll just get an automorphism. In my definition. You can define it differently, but so far, now, yes. But after all, it's Wednesday program and groups. We want to have groups. So we want to define on these guys a group structure. But if you look, for example, look at this thing here. You cannot compose this. It's a map between two forests. You cannot compose it. Why? Well, simply because the image is not contained in the domain. This here, these edges here, they are in the image, but they are not in the domain. So how we resolve this problem is by going to equivalence classes. And namely, what we could just do is cut out a bigger forest, a bigger subtree, and then it might work out. So is an equivalence class, and I will tell you in a minute how it goes. Equivalence class of forest isomorphisms. So let phi from t z minus t1 to t minus t2, and let also psi from t without t3 to t without t4. Let those two be forest isomorphisms. And then take a finite subtree such that t, for example, contains t1. Then I can simply restrict phi to the complement of t. And also if I require that t contains t4, then I can also just restrict. And then now it's a bit more complicated. I can restrict phi on t minus, what is it? Psi inverse t sub minus t4. That's how it makes sense, right? So I'm just here. I take something bigger. And I take something bigger.
I think
I wanted the blue one. Those colors don't match.
Maybe the
this one. Yeah.
Too much backslash. So you don't need a T minus, I think, in the last one. It's psi restricted to psi inverse of T minus.
My problem is that on T4, technically psi is not defined.
No, no, yes, but you don't need the first. Now you define it only on the inverse of T4, in a sense. So you don't need the first T minus.
This here?
Yes.
Ah, I understand. Right?
Because.
No, but otherwise, the C inverse of T is a finite subtree. But I need to define psi on the complement of a finite subtree.
No, no, but that now. Psi, T minus T4 is a cofinite subtree. So if you remove a cofinite, you just end up with finite. Suppose that psi is defined everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So now you look at only on what it does to T4.
Ah, wait, I need... Ah, no, I think I need to...
What is T1, 2?
What?
Is it the tree below? What is T1, 2, 3,
but why don't you just say that T contains T1 and T3?
Oh, because I want to end up with being able to compose T2.
Ah, you want to compose.
Yeah, and that's why the image of one
Me
the domain of the other.
But then you just... What you write is correct except the beginning. You just look at the psi minus...
Maybe only T4 on the inside of the...
Hmm? I think this is T minus T4 without T3. No,
it's just a finite set. Suppose that size.
No, this here's a finite set.
T, of course.
T is finite.
I think you are confused
between
T is finite.
T is not a tree. Okay.
This is finite.
Yeah, okay.
I need to subtract this because otherwise the inverse is not defined. Right? Okay, so this here is T4. Now I want the blue one.
I will look for
the
blue one for you.
No, I have a blue one. It just has a red cover. Okay, so this here is T4, this here is T. So this here's the difference. The difference gets mapped here somewhere. And what I then need to subtract, and it's a stupid technicality that everybody can do himself, but anyway, I got stuck into this, so I'll finish it. Now this difference is here, and now I need to subtract from the whole tree that upstairs and this little difference. That's an easy concept made way too complicated. Bottom line is, afterwards I will be able to choose the first tree I subtract or the second tree I subtract freely as I want, as long as they are big. Okay, so should have done this before, but I make it now. Equivalence class, I say phi is equivalent to phi prime if where phi prime goes from t without t1 prime to t without t2 prime. It's not prime, it's tilde. If there exists a T containing both of them, T1 prime, such that on the complement, they are the same. Okay, just mixing now a bit up the composing, the trying to define composition and the forming of the equivalence class. So after I make this equivalence relation, I can say this element, this restriction, is the same as phi, and this restriction is the same as psi. And now I can compose. Is this clear? Because I was, because I did that very confusedly.
So you, two automorphisms are the same if they don't agree only on a finite subtree.
Two almost automorphisms are the same if
they agree on everything but a finite subtree.
Yes. Yes. If you can cut out a huge subtree such that on the rest they agree.
But if it's really automorphism. Then if they don't agree on, they cannot, it's impossible for two automorphisms not to agree on a finite tree. But for almost automorphism.
Yeah,
and these things in general, they will really not be tree automorphisms. If you look at this picture again of what I cut out originally, what you see in the first picture is a tree of diameter 6. And what you see here is a tree of diameter 1, 2, 3, 4, 7 or so. So, I mean, the longest path in here has length 6, the longest path in here has length 7 at least. So there's no way these two are isomorphic. There's no way how you could, in general, how you could extend an almost automorphism from here to here, to a tree automorphism. Okay? And so the set of, or no, it's a group, right? We believe it's a group. We form by the inverse just by going the other way around. we have composition now. Group of almost automorphisms of tree is denoted by O odd T. And there's an alternate way, if you want to spare us this whole equivalence definition, this whole equivalence class business, then there's an alternative way of seeing that. Namely, Gill introduced the boundary of a tree, and we could see an almost automorphism just as acting in the boundary. So there's a equivalence class of array like going here, and we can just look at what does it do to this equivalence class. Maybe sends it here, and so we could also see the almost automorphism group as a subgroup of the homeomorphism group of the boundary. And here I'm using one of the assumptions on the tree. Should I ask questions in the audience? Do you see which assumption I'm using here? If I see this here as a subset of the homeomorphism group of the boundary.
It's a countable tree.
Well, I don't even have countable in the assumptions, but I don't know if I'm now countable. I don't even think I use here.
If every rank is fine.
I have here two assumptions. No leaves, no isolated points in the boundary.
Maybe it should be irregular?
There are no leaves.
Then it could be the whole.
But there are no leaves? I don't know.
That's the other one. 50% mischance. Now look, for example, at this tree. It doesn't have leaf, but it has the boundaries two, you know, like Z. The boundary has two, it's just two sets. And then the homomorphism group of the boundary consists of two elements. But the almost automorphism group is a bit bigger because I could cut, for example, just this here is my T1.
Even the automorphism group is
bigger. Yeah.
You don't need to cut, you just translate.
I didn't yet say that the automorphism group embeds, but okay, that's another way to do it, yes. And this is my T2 and set this half tree here and this half tree here, or I could choose T2 much bigger. So that's how I get infinitely many non-equivalent, almost automorphisms, but the boundary is a finite group, so that's a problem with leaves. If I have, no, that's a problem with isolated points in the boundary. If I have isolated points in the boundary, then I can always cut there a bit more and shift that ray downstairs. Now we're getting to the first assumption.
Okay.
Yeah?
Can you give an example for something that is a homomorphism of the boundary, but not...
No, the tree almost automorphism, yes, I can. As soon as
that's
I erase
not,
here.
Like a fix.
Again?
No, that doesn't fix as the...
It can, for example, hang the tree like this. And you can cut out everywhere here and map this one to this here, this one to this here, this one to here, this here, this one to this here, and so on. So you can like cut away infinitely many pieces. And so another way to think of this tree almost automorphism group is it's those homomorphisms of the boundary which around. Okay, this is not true for regular trees in general. Around every point of the boundary, it locally looks as if it's coming from a tree automorphism. But here, it will fail at this boundary point and at this boundary point. Around there, you will find no neighborhood where it looks like a tree, like a real tree automorphism.
So it's not a homomorphism of the boundary. Is it a homomorphism of the boundary?
Wait, this here is a homomorphism of the boundary.
Yeah.
It's continuous. And bijective. Then, as Zachik mentioned, there's the observation that the automorphism tree embeds into the group of almost automorphisms. And here we use the other assumption. Here we use that the tree does not have any leaves. Why that? Consider again an extreme, namely the tree has only leaves. Many, many leaves. It's a finite tree. Consider, a finite tree. Like, I don't know, maybe this here. Then this group is finite. The automorphism group is finite. So, it's not trivial. It has elements.
So, I didn't understand the previous example.
This example?
What did we do there?
I'm just hanging the tree, so along a line,
yeah.
And I
Maybe you want to switch each pair? You just did a shift?
I just did a shift.
But the shift is an automorphism.
But it's
you're
not
right.
hyperbolic because when you consider... No, but if you...
You're right. You're of course right. I want to switch names.
Huh?
No, you're right. What I did was just a tree automorphism.
Mm-hmm.
I want to switch to neighboring ones.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
But if you switch even one pair, and like you do something that avoids it from being just a hyperbolic element.
Mm-hmm.
Then the rest you kind of, you cannot translate because you will be stuck in the place you switched. Another one. Or you can keep translating from what's happening to the left of the place you switched. Yeah, this should also work. Never mind.
There are many things which work, mm-hmm. and I'm just sure that this one doesn't, what it previously didn't. Okay. So here in this case, when I have leaves, then I could, when I form an almost automorphism, I could just cut out the whole tree, right? I can cut out always a bigger finite subtree, so why don't I cut out everything? So in this case, the almost automorphism group is trivial, because every almost automorphism is equivalent to the empty map. That's why I need the assumption that there are no leaves. Also for an infinite tree, if I make a pair of leaves here, then I can always cut the pair of leaves out, and these leaves will not be seen in the almost automorphism group, but they will be seen in the automorphism group. So that's why I assume no leaves, because I really want this to be a subset. Because this here we use to define a topology. So we want this to be a topological group, so we can just claim or require that this inclusion is continuous and open. So it maps open sets to open sets. But there's something to prove. We need to show that it actually will give a topology. But how we can see this is now odd T is sitting as an open group inside the almost automorphism group. So in particular, if a sequence converges to the identity, then for big N, this almost automorphism actually have to be automorphisms. So the rest of the time before the break, I want to spend on explaining why this actually gives a topology. You did the topology, not T, right? Yeah, you for sure did. So I'll use a lemma here from Bolbaki. Thank you. a group. And let curly B be a filter on the group. Does everybody know what it means? A filter on a set?
I do, I showed it last week, no?
I showed it too, so.
Ah, נכון, כאילו כן, זה מה שהתכוונת כאן.
You were talking about this.
Shivi presented filters in his talk about uniform spaces.
Okay. So, great, so I don't need to explain it. Because I also didn't prepare to explain it. Satisfying the following.
You can explain it again.
What did he explain this year? This lemma?
No.
I don't know what you're going to write. So.
Yes, sir. Was it about defining a topology on
using
a group?
Filters? No.
Okay. Find the following. First condition is for every B should be thought of afterwards as the neighborhoods, not open, but neighborhoods of the identity element, right? So what do we want from a neighborhood of the identity? We want that if we multiply it by itself, it's still a neighborhood. We want that the inverse is still a neighborhood. And then the third is a bit more complicated. The third has more to do with continuity of the multiplication. We want that if we conjugate, there's still a neighborhood inside the intersection. Wait, how does this precisely go? No, actually. Yeah. Huh? Right. So for every phi in the group, and for every neighborhood, U in the neighborhood, the conjugation is still a neighborhood. Then,
do you require the identities inside all of these U?
No, it should follow, right? Because it should follow from this
from one
year.
And two together,
uh-huh. Not?
Probably yes. If U and U inverse is there, so E is inside the product.
Means that there is a neighborhood of identity.
Okay. But it's not, it doesn't mean for all.
Why not requiring that?
Yeah.
I mean, maybe it follows together with the assumption that it's a filter, but without the assumption that it's a filter, it doesn't follow from
mm-hmm.
the assumption. Why not?
What are you talking about?
The question is, why is the identity inside? I said this should in the end be the set of neighborhoods of the identity, but...
Let's say a filter of sets containing the identity.
No, and
because U
zero for every U.
U minus a hard is inside.
No.
So that means that every
there exists one.
There exists.
If you just look at a group and a locally compact group, take any topological group and take all open sets, they satisfy 1, 2, and 3.
But if U minus a hard is there and U kaful U is there, then U kaful U minus a hard is there.
So
okay,
some sets contain
the
identity.
But
you want all sets.
But then, okay, but then if we assume this zero,
no, for every
then
you,
one
for you, you want it for every
I
you.
I want for every.
But then you don't need one.
Yeah.
But okay, but it doesn't matter. Because if you assume this zero, then one is obvious, no? Because U times U contains U.
No, this is a requirement.
Right? So then requirement one follows, isn't it?
No, no. It's not true without, you have to assume zero, otherwise it's not true.
Or even maybe you wanted to intersection of all the use equals identity?
No,
then
just give me some separation axiom.
So the main collality, you don't want
it to be as you times you collality.
Sure, in the end, what I say,
yeah, so.
אם U כוללת אחת, אז U times U כוללת U.
אבל למה שזה יהיה בביג?
ואז זה יהיה בביג כי ביוחד, הוא סגור
כפה מה. Here is a counter example. Look at Z with the Zariski or the co-finite topology. It's a filter, but it's not everything contains zero.
It's not a group topology.
No, but I'm saying...
It's not a group topology, but it... Nobody said
anything. Oh, so, okay, we're thinking about
pop. No, but I'm saying, like, if you assume zero, you just don't need to say one, because one is obvious, because you take a U in B, then U times U for sure contains U, because U contains one. And then anyways, because the filter is closed upwards, then U times
U, you don't
need
one.
You don't need one.
That's
what I'm saying.
But
yes, you're right.
Okay.
But you need...
So you can leave it anyhow.
What is the conclusion?
Then there exists a unique group topology on G such that this curly B is the set of, or is it just is A neighborhood basis of id identity. So from the conclusion it should somehow be, it's really important that one is inside. Maybe we discover, I need to look it up. Okay. Now I want to apply this lemma to make sure that the group topology I just claimed to be there on the tree almost automorphism group is actually a topology. What is this curly B now? Right? I want to find a neighborhood. I want to find the curly B for all T. So it's just all those neighborhoods which are open, which would be have an open intersection around the identity inside odd T. So there exists an open identity of an open neighborhood of the identity O in odd T. This is the candidate of B that we want. If this candidate of B works, then it's clear that odd T is sitting in openly inside. Because it just means the open sets around the identity in here and in here are the same. So 1 and 0, 1 and 2 are obvious. Is this B? Are the questions to 0? 0 is clear because every neighborhood of the identity contains the identity. 1 is clear because it's true in odd T. This open neighborhood inside, you multiply it by itself, you get an open neighborhood inside which sits in the whole U. And same with the inverse about 2. So 0, 1, 2 is clear. Inutro checks 3. Now what 3? Better get to my notes to not screw up notation. So let phi be an almost automorphism. And u in v. What does this mean? U in B means there exists a tree, finite subtree, such that, how did you denote this, the fixator of the tree is inside U. Did you denote it like this?
Yeah, okay. I don't think so, but I don't remember how I denote it, but it doesn't.
So this is the pointwise fixator of the tree in odd t. And that's by the definition of the topology in odd t. A set in odd t is open, well, an identity, a set in odd t is an identity neighborhood if and only if it contains such a thing. And we can make T as big as possible, as big as we want. If we make T big, then it just means we make T smaller, and if it was previously contained, it will be still contained. And also here, this here had two finite subtrees, which we cut out to define it. Also these we can make arbitrarily big, so by enlarging T, if necessary, we can represent phi as, where do I want the prime? Phi as going from the complement of T to the complement of some P prime, some T prime. But then what happens if I conjugate? If now take the conjugate phi times the fixator of t times phi to the minus 1. So what does it do? Phi to the minus 1 sends the complement of this tree to the complement of this tree. Then here nothing happens and this sends it back. What happens to one leaf? Let's say this here is not t, this is t prime. What happens to one leaf? One leaf here gets mapped somewhere, then here nothing happens to it, and then it gets sent back to itself again. So this here is an almost automorphism, which is actually, this actually could be written as this complement of t prime to complement of t prime, but what happens on the leaves of t prime? They stay fixed. So this almost automorphism, I can extend to an actual automorphism, and what will this actual automorphism do? It will do nothing on t prime. So this here is nothing but the fixator of
it contains
t prime. What?
It just contains the fixator of t prime.
We can show easily that it's actually, because it works the other way around too, right? So
okay.
Right, if I take fixator of, if I take an element of the fixator and I conjugate it, same argument, I get an element in the fixator of T.
I agree.
Okay. But now, that means, but that here means then of course that phi u, phi to the minus 1, contains fixator of t prime, which is the statement of 3. So now we proved that there's a well-defined topology on the three levels. automorphism groups. And it's also a good point to make a break.